ดีอย่างเป็นทางการอีกครั้งนะครับ Good afternoon everybody. Welcome to the second session. We have two documentaries on these sessions and it's about Burma. And after we see these two documentaries, then we will have the discussion same as the first session. And we are lucky, we are very lucky today that we have two specialists on Burma to discuss about the film and the story behind the film documentary. So please let me introduce our discussants first. The first one was Kun Emily Ho here. She is a PhD candidate at Cornell University on anthropology and also a filmmaker. So besides the Burma, Myanmar things, we can asking her about, you know, how she as a director see these documentaries. And also we have here Ajahn Dr. Lalita Han Wong from Kasetsart University. She is a lecturer in history. She is expert on Burma histories. And since we have two documentaries, and the first one actually both is about the protests, and I think not everyone of us has a background on the Burma Myanmar thing, so I think it's a good idea. I just asked her just before to give us a brief of the stories before we begin นะครับก็ภาษาไทยด้วยแล้วกันนะครับก็จะขอให้อาจารย์ลลิตาช่วยอธิบายสักประมาณ 3-5 นาทีเกี่ยวกับเหตุการณ์นะครับของเรื่องราวที่เกิดขึ้นในพม่าเป็นเหตุการณ์ที่เรียกว่า8888นะครับก็เป็นเหตุการณ์สำคัญนะครับซึ่งเป็นหน้าประวัติศาสตร์ที่สำคัญซึ่งก็จะเป็นฐานของสารคดีที่เราจะชมในวันนี้นะครับทั้งสองเรื่องนะครับก็เรียนเชิญครับอาจารย
์ Okay guys good afternoon to you as he said my name is Lalita a Sanskrit name with a Chinese faceAnyway, so I was assigned to talk a bit about the 8888 movement in Burma, Myanmar today. Within 3 to 5 minutes, that's a bit impossible, but I'm going to try to do so. For those of you who are familiar with Thai student movements, you know, you should know events during the 1970s, during the 6th of October and the 14th of October and the 6th of October. Yeah, if those events in Thailand are watershed in understanding contemporary Thai history, modern Thai politics, and so on, this is it for contemporary Burma Myanmar. Yeah.It's a big event, but for me it's more important than a big event per se, because for me students in Myanmar politics, they are an institution, not just a movement. Why? Coming back to Thailand, we have the three kinds of institutions. We have three institutions. Yeah, we have the nation, whatever it is. I don't even know what it is exactly.We have Buddhism as, well, they don't say it's a state religion, but people convince me in this country that it is a state religion anyway. And then we have the third institution, the monarchy, kingship. Yeah? In Burma, the king is dead, yeah? Long dead, long deposed by the British in 1825. The nation,very vague. you know, you don't really know what a Burmese or a Myanmar nation is. People still arguing about this, whether we should call Burma Burma or we should call it Myanmar. Yeah, so a nation in terms of Burmese Myanmar politics always been controversial. So let's put it aside for a moment. And then for Buddhism, Buddhism is there. Buddhism in Myanmar has always beenquite strong, but because Buddhism in Myanmar has lacked clear-cut leadership, not like in Thailand, where we still have the Prasangkarat or the how you call it, the chief abbot, you know, the greatest guy in Buddhism in Thailand. But in Burma, it's very different. Leadership hasn't always been clear, and the last Thathanabai or Sankaran was deposed, was abolished by the British many years, well, a century ago. Yeah. So this is how students came to the political scene in Myanmar, because students came to lead, students came to be someone who could lead a political movement, a political upheaval, first as an anti-colonial upheaval during, I think it started during 1920s, but it wasn't exactly a student movement. A student movement started probably sometime just before the Second World War, during the 1930s, yeah, with an organization called YMBA, as in YMCA. It's pretty much the same thing. Young Men's Buddhist Association. So from then on, you know, with key leaders like Aung San, with the rest of these people, they led this movement, and they finally liberalized Myanmar from British colonial rule. Yeah. So from independence onwards, the role of student movements in Burma and Myanmar hasn't actually declined at all, because they have always been active in political life of Burma, Myanmar. I'll give you another example. In 1962, when there was a coup staged by General Ne Win, once again we could see students come forward, and they protested against the General Ne Win's government. Yeah, and at the time in 1962, the historic student union building inside Rangoon or Yangon University was dynamited. It was, you know, blown up. Yeah, there were many people stuck in the building. A lot of students died during this event, during these protests, nationwide protests during 1962. From 1962. Here comes this very event that we are talking about. We're going to watch the first film, which is going to talk about this event of 1988. Why is it called 8888, the four eights? Yeah, in Burmese it's called Shit Le Long. Shit is eight, Le is four, Long is anything round. Yeah, so the four eights. Why is it called the four eights? Because this event, it's actually a series of events. Yeah, it did not start on the 8th of August 1988. It actually started during sometime in March 1988, and it reached its peak sometime in September or July and August 1988. Anyway, this event led to, I think, hundreds of deaths among students, among policemen as well, and among monks. Yeah. So that is not just the importance of this event. Now, I'm going to talk a bit more about what Burmese people call 88 generation. Now, when you talk about this, you always see this guy somewhere in the movement. Oh, yeah, it happens to this country sometimes. It's always error. Nothing works. Anyway, you see this guy. Mitsima. Okay, you see this guy who's it's not a real name, but people know him as Mingo Nai. Mingo Nai is a pseudonym, let's put it that way. Yeah, it's not a real name. But that's how he is known of inside and outside Burma. So this guy was a student during this protest. And he, together with his student colleagues, staged a protest, and the protest, you know, I think it started somewhere in Yangon, and then it spread throughout the country. It became a nationwide protest and a really, really significant movement, a student movement and key event in Myanmar, contemporary Myanmar politics. Yeah. So this kind of person like Mingo Nai, he became like an inspiration, you know, he gave so much energy to Myanmar politics, and you know, with this kind of face, you know exactly that students these days that you will see in the second film, these students think of people like Mingo Nai as a role model, you know, and they just want to make some real change in Myanmar politics. Now, you may ask me, you know, Myanmar is democratic now, you know, they had an election, so things must be good. Yeah? With Aung San Suu Kyi in office and all that, you know, Myanmar is, you should look at the bright side. Yeah, but why students are protesting still? No, they protested before the general election last year. But anyway, for me personally, you don't have to believe me. I really don't think that Myanmar is completely democratic at the moment. There are so many things that the government has to do. There's so many things they have been trying to do. But we have to be fair to everyone, and you know, it's going to take years and years and years, if not decades, for this country to become fully democratic. Yeah.
Sorry, sorry.
Myanmar, not Thailand.
Yes, you have like an hour after this.
Okay. So I'll stop now, and you see the rest. You know how I feel, and you know how I. Yeah, you get the idea after you watch the films.
คร่าวๆก็คือปี1988มีเหตุการณ์ประท้วงใหญ่นะครับซึ่งก็จริงๆมันเป็นเหตุการณ์ที่ถูกบ่มเพาะมาก่อนหน้านั้นพอสมควรนะครับหลังจากที่ประชาชนพม่าเนี่ยถูกกดขี่โดยรัฐบาลทหารนะครับแล้วก็มีการประท้วงใหญ่ในปี1988นะครับแล้วก็เหตุการณ์ที่เราจะได้ดูในสารคดีเนี่ยก็จะเป็นเหตุการณ์ที่เป็นเหตุการณ์ต่อเนื่องจากการประท้วงในครั้งนั้นนะครับSo, please join me welcome our discussants, Dr. Lalita and Kun Emily Hong. So I think we better start with the first documentaries, which is the consequence of the so-called 8888. So, better start with Emily. What do you feel, and what is the message that the director would like to convey to us?
I actually have comments about both of the films together. So, did you want to comment on the first film? In particular, first?
Yeah, that's okay, because it's, yeah.
Okay, I just thought I'll start by talking a little bit about the two films and then go into some details about each of the films. But I also look forward to engagement comments from the audience as well. Okay, so I wanted to start by talking a little bit about how these two short films actually give you a good sense of two of the big filmmaking schools in Myanmar. Myanmar, I'm actually retraining myself to say Myanmar, but now I see the trend is Burma/Myanmar. In Myanmar, they don't actually have filmmaking or video production available at any of the universities. That's what I've been told. And so actually most of the training that people get in filmmaking is from these non non-informal training institutes. And so actually, you may have noticed that the first film, Mother and Son, is a Yangon Film School production at the end, in the credits, and 60 Days comes out of the Human Rights, Human Dignity Institute. You know, of course, as a filmmaker myself, I wouldn't want to claim that their filmmaking approaches are entirely dictated by the schools from where they come. But on the other hand, I think especially as early career filmmakers, there's no doubt that your approach to filmmaking is shaped by the way that you're trained, at least to a certain extent. Maybe it's later in your career that you can kind of break out of that mold. Mother and Son is kind of in the mold of Yangon Film School's classic character-driven documentary. And of course, this film is focused on the mother of political prisoner that went on. And I think if you see many of the other first-time films from this school, they're also based almost always on single character-driven documentaries. And as opposed to relying on the kind of talking heads interviews, which we often see in a mainstream documentary. Another thing you may have noticed is the way that the filmmaker paired the narrative of the mother with the kind of ethnographic scenes, whether it's longer takes or shorter B-roll. And I think that in combination with the more naturalistic soundtrack is actually very different from mainstream Myanmar film. You might have noticed that the cinematography is very much based on kind of carefully composed tripod shots. And I think that also shows the film school's focus on production value first before maybe some other things. And I don't know if any of you have seen the school director Lindsay Marison is also a filmmaker, and if you haven't seen any of her films, I really recommend Friends in High Places. It's from 2000, but it's actually about spirit mediums, and it's quite powerful and very ethnographic in terms of its attention to everyday life. But I think from maybe the way that she has shaped the training in the school, and this is my speculation since I've never actually sat in on their trainings, but I can kind of imagine what are the kinds of directions that their trainers give to the filmmakers because of the similarities that I see in the films that come out of there. So in contrast, I'll talk about 60 Days and how I see some of the similarities between that film and other films that come out of the Human Rights, Human Dignity Institute. And many of the films that I've seen come out of there, of course, are unabashedly political. Often they're driven by a passion for the subject rather than sort of the technical details. And I think that, you know, it shows that sometimes the production value may be a little bit inconsistent. But when the production elements come together with the compelling content, I think you can see very powerful moments. And for example, I thought the opening of the film, 60 Days, was especially powerful, you know, with the series of shots kind of zooming out of the university building, followed by the street protests from, you know, the kind of low angle shots and handheld shots, you know, kind of really gave a very energetic opening to the film. So the Human Rights, Human Dignity Institute founder, that film, it's actually closely related to the Human Rights, Human Dignity Film Festival. And it was started apparently in collaboration with Daw Aung San Suu Kyi. And I don't know what her involvement looks like now, now that she has a slightly different position. But it's still the film festival. It coincides actually with her birthday every year. So there's a bit of a history there. And I would just say that I haven't seen necessarily, I just hope that in the future that relationship doesn't constrain any of the potential decisions being made, but I doubt that it will. But it's just something to consider that association with the lady may not from it not from not necessarily especially from ethnic areas perspectives that it's not always associated with human rights and human dignity in this current moment. And if you're interested in other films that are coming out of that institute, one that I saw at the festival this past year called What's on Your Mind, I think is very relevant to the Thai context. It focuses on the stories of three political prisoners who, the first political prisoners in Burma, in Myanmar, to be prosecuted for their posts on Facebook. And I think obviously that resonates quite strongly with what we've seen in Thailand recently. So just a couple of comments on each individual film. Mother and Son, I thought, had really strong usage of archival footage. I had never seen that footage of Nay Win basically warning of the things to come on 8888. So for me, that was a very chilling moment. I especially thought that the narrative arc was quite strong. You know, not only the choice of the narrator, but actually, you know, the editing that went into constructing this really strong narrative arc that stretches all the way from 1988 to this, you know, the son going into hiding, the imprisonment, and then, of course, to the protests 2014 and 2015 on the education law. And, you know, of course, when a narrative arc works, sometimes we take it for granted, but you know, I think there must have been a lot of work that went in behind the scenes to make that happen, especially for those of us who may not be familiar with all the historical details that some of the academics who are working on political history in Burma may be familiar with. And I think that this is especially difficult when working on a historical documentary, although there's different challenges between working on a documentary kind of after the fact than there are, of course, if you have too much footage of things that have happened, which I think, you know, is a challenge for constructing a narrative as well, I think, as what we saw in 60 Days. I thought that there was a very strong connection made between the 88 protests and the recent ones on education, especially the connection in terms of parents and their own experiences and sacrifices. I personally would have liked to see longer pauses without language to kind of sit with those moments of strong emotion. And the editing and sound design, I think, were very strong and gave a bit more space to the viewer than did 60 Days. But I do hope that in the future that the director Thuy Thuy Nguyen Nguyen will take more risks. I'd like to see her taking more risks in terms of narrative form as well as cinematography. For 60 Days, you know, as I kind of alluded to earlier, I think that the narrative cohesion was a little bit more challenging for those of us who don't know the details of the protests against the education law. So. But that being said, I think the film takes more risks and it should be celebrated for that. I thought that the handheld cinematography worked really well, especially on the streets. And I found it exciting to look at Ko Zia Luen's travels to different parts of the country that we see in his building up support for the nationwide movement. I personally would have wished, I wish that the directors would have put more confidence in the primary character to tell the story rather than relying on the kind of outside experts, which of course added more information, but you know, I think there's always a trade-off. Do you add more information or do you kind of help people get a hold of what's going on in the story? I think maybe the only exception is the president's advisor on education. I just kind of got a kick out of the way that she talked. But I think that I personally wanted to see the main character kind of counter those opinions directly. And I also think that we learned quite a bit more from the main character's interaction and debates with his fellow students than those talking heads. But despite that, I think the film does a great job of stirring, could be great for discussions around the education issue and for also showing the militancy of these young activists. So just a couple of final remarks. You know, for me, the films represented politics with a big P much more than the kind of politics in everyday life that maybe we would have, you know, as was the call for films for these for this year or for last year. But I do think that from Mother and Son, for example, we get some really important firsthand insight into what is what are the sacrifices that families of political activists have to face, especially the impact of the government's policy for putting prisoners really far from their families. I mean, you hear in the film that actually the political prisoner, he was placed, I think, in Sagaing, all the way up in the north, and then switched over to another prison, and then switched over to Mandalay. You know, this is a huge toll on the political prisoners as well as their families. But I also wanted to add that I think, I hope that we'll have more films, I don't know of any that exist, where we see the sacrifices made by families with ties to ethnic political leaders, especially those from ethnic armed organizations, because, you know, as some of you may know, those, you know, the wives of many of the ethnic armed leaders have been imprisoned, daughters, sons, in order to get an education, they've had to leave the country or to move and kind of pretend to be someone else's relative, you know, so they're also making quite a bit of sacrifices based on political activism and resistance. For 60 Days, I thought that it had the potential to spark conversation, and I'd love to hear your perspectives about the militancy of activism and especially the gendered aspects. And I'm not sure this was intended as part of the film, but I thought that some of the scenes kind of suggested some insights into what the challenges might be for young women activists. And also there's that one scene where you see a student talking about ethnic languages, so to the extent that there's challenges for young ethnic activists in these spaces, which, you know, I imagine must be quite dominated by men and Bamar men in particular. And I know that activists and young people were in many ways profoundly disappointed by the results of all of their sacrifices for this education law. And, you know, I haven't followed, you know, any updates recently, but what I understand is that the law, when it was passed, took out this reference to unions, to Thamaga, which they talked about in the film, and also, you know, of course, it remained quite of a centralized education system, which was another thing that was mentioned in the film. But any of the small wins that I think you do see from the student movement are no doubt a result of a lot considerable bravery and community support for those activists. And I would say, if anything, the film shows that there is a continued necessity for courage when it comes to political action in Burma, Myanmar. Despite the semblance of democratic rule, and I think Ajahn Lalitha kind of referenced in her introduction that, you know, we have to question to what extent this is democracy and how long democracy will take. And despite the opening of media, I think it's pretty hard to you know, everyone mostly agrees that there's been quite a change in terms of how the media has opened, but in terms of the state's willingness to crack down on peaceful protest, I think not much has changed, I would say. So I'll leave it there for my comments.
Thank you very much. It's very useful and very insightful, and I think this will be very useful for some of us that are filmmakers, also the directors of these two documentaries that they don't have a chance to be here, but we have
the video record, so I think somehow they'll get your advice. So I will go to Dr. Lalita, ครับ.
Yeah.
Yes. So what is your feeling after you see these two documentaries?
Would you mind if I compare 60 Days with the case we are facing in Thailand at the moment? You know, it's been quite critical in Thailand the past few months, where we've got a student activist imprisoned at the moment, and I'm not sure if I can tell you correctly these legal terms. I'm not very much into law, but anyway. You know, this guy, whose name is Pai Chattopadhyay, he has been in prison for about 2 months now, almost 2 months now. He was charged with an accusation of mocking the legal institution in Thailand. First of all, he was first imprisoned because he shared a BBC post about the present king, King Rama the X. You know, thousands and thousands of people, shared that post, but nobody has been charged with anything except him. Yeah, so he was put in prison, but he was finally released 2 months ago. He was imprisoned again. Because the judges in Khon Kaen thought of him as, you know, mocking the legal system and so on, so he's now in jail, and he has been rejected. How do you call it? You know, he could have got out.
Bail.
Yeah, bail. That's right. Yeah. This is the fifth time that he has been rejected bail. Yeah. Everyone should have the right to get this bail, yeah, but he's been rejected, so that's one issue. I really wish that this film, 60 Day, can be watched by every Thai student, so they would understand how students from neighboring country like Burma has, you know, they have been struggling so hard in, you know, standing side by side with the people, you know, fighting for justice, fighting for freedom, and above all, fighting for democracy. Yeah. Looking back, I'm a lecturer, yeah, and I've been now for 6 months now. I've been at one of the most, well, arguably the most conservative universities in Thailand, Kasetsart University. It's essentially an agricultural university. Yeah. So. Very conservative, very right-wing. Anyway, I'm not complaining. I'm just telling you some stories about my university. So that's how I really want you guys to reflect upon what's going on in Thailand, and I really want you to understand that the situation in Thailand today is very different from Burma. Like, I've heard so many people talking about Burma, like, you know, Burma hasn't really been democratic, you know, Burma has to do lots of things in order to be fully democratic and so on. But, you know, when looking at this country, we're actually worse, yeah? At least in 60 days, you see the government and the parliament, the lawmakers, the governments, and the two organizations, yeah, NNER and the other one, and the student union, they come, at least they have discussion, yeah, and at least the government try to do something about it, they try to solve the problem. I don't know if they genuinely wanted to, but at least they had a discussion. That would never happen in this country, ever. Yeah, especially under this current government. Too much ego, so much power going on, power struggle as well. So we're never gonna see it. Yeah? The government is trying to say, we need to reconcile, we need to bring you know, lots of groups together, we have to come together and unite our country. You know, we have had conflicts too much already, and it's time for change. Make Thailand great again. But This kind of thing will never happen in this country under this premier, this prime minister, sorry. that's one insight that I really want to discuss and probably argue with you guys if you wish to. My final remark actually is about symbols and mainly about symbols that you see from 60 Days and the first film, Mother and Son, mainly. For me, since the 1930s, and particularly since the 1940s, the image, the character of student movement in Burma hasn't changed at all. You look at the costume of the students. You look at some certain symbols, the boycott symbols, the arm, the upside down arms. It's still the same. And Aung San used that, UNU used that, early day nationalist leaders used this kind of symbol before. So you can still see that. And one thing that you might be questioning why it's here, you see the flag, the student union, well, the Maga flag, the red flag with the yellow peacock. Yeah. Do you understand why it's pretty much the same as NLD's flag? Because it's the same flag. Anyway, it was the kind of flag that the nationalist leaders used during the YMBA struggle during the 30s and 40s, and the whole student union was led mainly by Aung San and other people. Yeah, but the most important one, I wouldn't say the most important one, but the most dominant one was General Aung San. Yeah. But at the same time, there were so many people taking part in the student movement during the 30s and the 40s. So they used this kind of symbol before. And of course, because NLD was established at the aftermath of 1988 protests, they had to use this kind of spirit, the student spirit, because student spirit is everywhere. It was everywhere, and it's now everywhere. You can see in the second film that the two arguably most important institutions in Burma are the students and the monks. And you can see that the monks took part in the latest, 2006, 2006 Saffron Revolution. That was mainly led by monks. But in 1988 and in 2014-15, these protests were led mainly by students. So you can see that they are pretty much related. You can tell from one of the scenes in 60 Days where an abbot, he gave an interview and he said, we must stand by students, we must do something about it, we cannot protest ourselves, but we have to help them, just like the people, Burmese people, are always in the background. During the 40s, they came out at the forefront of the protests with leadership of the student union, the All Burma student union led by Aung San and other people. Myanmar people are always at the background. They might want to be at the forefront of the whole protest, but they cannot. The leadership is there, and in this case, it's the student. You see people crying, you see people shouting, you see people dancing because of this this march in four cities in Myanmar. So it's quite something. And every time, recently I've been back to Burma, and these days you would normally find elderly people, Burmese elderly people, talking to you like, we don't trust children anymore. Children these days are not that good. Children these days are not as good as our generation. They're good for nothing. They like to play more than you know, get proper education and so on. But, you know, at the same time, looking back at this film, children are not useless. You know, I don't know, but there are good and there are bad students. But in this film, we see the spirit of student movement that we saw in the 40s, in the 30s and the 40s, and also in the 60s. Yeah, there are some really, really good and very much engaged students, like students that we see in this film. But at the same time, you know, everywhere the same. There are people who just don't give a shoot about anything whatsoever. Yeah, but these days it's just my reflection that I've heard so many complaints from elderly people that, you know, Burma needs more students like this. Yeah, and you can see in this film that, you know, elderly people are very much emotional about student movements, and they really want to help. They donate money, they donate food, they donate everything. They put so much effort into student movement. So basically, my conclusion is students, and probably monks also, can unite the whole Burma. I'm not talking about the ethnic part of Burma, because I don't know much about this, but students and monks can unite the Burma world, if you know what I mean. Yeah, the Burmese world, to be exact. Yeah, so that sums up everything that I said. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You just raised a very important point, you know, to compare between our situation nowadays with Burma, which is also going on for decades and still going on these days, you know. And yeah, I can see lots in common between Thailand and Burma if we look in every content and context, you know. And actually, yes, I just quite agree with you that when we talk about Burma, people talking about, you know, this day, development, democracy and futures of Burma, some kind of fed up with what happened these days. But when we look at these kids, you know, and we look at our students that still today in jail, I see the future. I see that this country, these two countries still have future if we have this kind of, you know, students. Yeah. So do you have any things to
It's
add
different.
On?
It's different though. In our country, people don't care about students. Middle class people do not stand for students. They don't support students. Like, my parents wouldn't care about them. My parents wouldn't know about Pai in jail. Yeah?
But when you talk about middle class, you yourself also middle class.
I am a middle class.
And you care about him.
I do care about him because
right.
I'm an alternative kind of middle class.
Okay, so do you want to add anything? Okay, yes. So, anyone have any comments or suggestions? Yes, Bob, please.
Now that I've come to the
My name is Robert Cummings. My specialty is actually overseas Chinese, and which is neither filming nor Myanmar. So, I want to thank both Emily and Lolita. Your explanation of the context was very enlightening, and Emily, your explanation of filmmaking techniques, that was really interesting. What struck me then is that in neither of the films does the driving ideology seem to come out very strongly. I wonder, you know, should that be a part of the filmmaking? Because we get that good narrative arc from mother and son, but what was driving that? You know, what were his principles that he was standing on? And even with the student movement, we get a little bit that, oh, they want free association. It's a very general term, democracy. But what does democracy mean? Does that just mean rule by the majority? You know, a tyranny of the majority? What about all those minority people in Myanmar? So the question then, to repeat it, is: do you see you agreed with that, that there's not a very strong ideological line where it's explaining the ideology, and if not, is there a place for that in filmmaking? Thank you.
Just to clarify, so you're suggesting that in Mother and Son that the ideology comes out quite strongly, but in the second film, you
neither
of them. Oh, I see. Okay. Okay. I personally think that there's always a space for ideology in film. I think it's a matter of how to work with it. I think it's really challenging. I've made a couple of films with activists, and I think as an activist myself, although not always intimately involved in those things that I've been filming, I think, you know, you have to make choices. Are you going to make the choice that an activist in the campaign would make, or are you going to make a choice that a filmmaker, a somewhat of an insider slash outsider would make? And I think it's really difficult to make those decisions. I think in 60 days, I'm not sure what the rationale behind the directing was, but we heard a lot of specific details about the laws, and I think that, at least from an outsider perspective, that was maybe the activist voice coming in and saying, okay, these are really important, we need to know the meaty details of the laws. But in terms of ideology, I think what would have helped, maybe it's less about ideology in the abstract and more about how that seeps into one's life story, I think is what people can connect to. So to understand what is the story or the particular journey of why did these two characters, one from each of the films, become so passionate about their political causes. We never hear about them, actually. You know, because we hear in the first film from the mother's perspective, and she doesn't seem to be totally keyed into the reasons why both of her sons got so involved. So I think, perhaps if they were longer films, feature films, then I would have liked to see maybe a bit more about the life story and how, not ideology in the abstract, but how is it that they became so motivated to work on these issues, because that's what people can empathize with.
Hi, my name is Janina. I'm a grad student at RCSD, and we've been having from our program a sort of conference in Mandalay last year that was organized in a joint venture of RCSD and University of Mandalay. And I was thinking it would be interesting to maybe talk about my impressions I had there. This was basically a conference where grad students from here in Chiang Mai and University of Mandalay would present their field research. And what I found very interesting about the ethnic minority students is that they are present at the universities. They have their research, and there is also teachers and professors from ethnic minorities. But the general theme is that it's very much the Burman teachers. They're like, oh yeah, we value that. We value ethnic minority students and teachers, and we value their research topics. But the underlying theme is, but they have to do how we want to do that. But on the other hand, I think the students, they are very much opening up towards having equality with ethnic minorities. And I personally am interested in the Rohingya topic. My master's thesis is about Rohingya migrants in Thailand. And I think one of the leaders of the Burma Student Union in Yangon, they posted a public picture saying, like, we are standing with Rohingya, which is very, very controversial, was a very big sign. So I think that there is changing something as well.
Okay, you want me to say something now, or okay? I've got one observation.
2 weeks ago, I was in Yangon, and I met a professor of anthropology from Mandalay University. And for some reason, you know, I was always very careful when talking to elderly people in Burma. I wouldn't start a conversation on the Rohingyas with them. But at the time, she was talking to me, and she raised this idea of talking about Rohingya with me. Yeah, and she was quite frustrated that, you know, people in Burma don't care about the Rohingyas, and more importantly, they encourage the persecution of the Rohingyas. Yeah, this is a professor and head of department of anthropology at Mandalay University. So I was quite surprised. You know, I've been told that, you know, all elderly people in Myanmar, they encourage this persecution, they don't like the Rohingyas. But this professor who graduated, she had a PhD from Kyoto or Tokyo, I'm not sure. So she told me that, you know, she did not agree with Myanmar people with this decision to neglect, ignore Rohingya people. So yeah, I was quite surprised. And also, a month ago, I saw one Facebook post by an indie funk, not funk, a rock band called Side Effect. Yeah, my colleague, one of my friends here would know, because he is a big fan of Side Effect. This is an alternative, an indie kind of band in Myanmar. And this guy, the leader of the band, posted on his Facebook, "We are standing with the Rohingyas." So I was like, wow, this is a breakthrough. This is quite something. You know, we would never see people like Zani, or Zani the musician, not Mount Zani. we would never see people like Zani or, you know, famous people expressing their ideas, their feelings about the Rangers in this way. But because this band, the Side Effect, is an indie band, I was quite shocked. Yeah, but the feedback from comments, if you want to learn lots of things, you learn from comments, yeah? And I saw comments, and it was positive too, yeah? Positive towards the Rohingyas. So I was like, wow, Burmese society is not what I thought it was, yeah? But there are lots of people who are frustrated about the situation. People who cannot talk about this openly in public with their colleagues, with their friends, with their family. I cannot talk about Thai politics with my parents because they would never agree with me. They would argue about it with me, and they would always be right. Yeah, I'm left. Anyway, so that's my observation about the current situation. So please, Amy.
I just wanted to add some information about the films that we've received from Myanmar. In the very first year when we started up this project, we only had a handful of documentaries come in. One of them was The Clinic by Ao Ming, who's now quite almost a celebrity now in the documentary film circuit in Myanmar. But in the first year when he came, he said that now that that the lid is being lifted off of Myanmar after such a long time, people are going to have lots of stories to tell. And he said, the only thing that will stop us is the fear of being able to tell the story. And so you will see that there's a general kind of, what would you call it, an opening now. And people have got many stories to tell, but I get a feeling over the last couple of years from the Yangon Film School and now from the Human Rights, Human Dignity Institute, that they want to push the limits of what they can do, what they can explore, what they can say. That it's not so much for an external audience, but for an internal audience to, you know, in Myanmar itself. And the Yangon Film School, until now, until last year anyway, they were doing screenings in Yangon, but it was very much under the radar. So people who know they're doing a screening will come to the yearly event, annual event. But it's as of this year, they've been requested to submit everything that they produced to the censorship, the film censorship board. And they've never been asked to do this before, so they're quite concerned that what they've been able to do until now under the radar, now in this new democratic transition period, that they might have to be making cuts here and there. So they are testing the waters. And this is there's nothing new in doing that. I mean, thinking about Spain when it transitioned, for example, from the Franco dictatorship period into democracy in the early 1980s, it was an explosion of people testing the water. And we're seeing another thing taking place now. It's a good thing to do, but it's something that they have to do. And it will take, it will be one step forward, one at a time. Another thing, in the 60 days, the chief advisor, she's talking about what languages they can be taught in. Yeah. We actually had Aung San Suu Kyi come to Kyoto University in November. She received an honorary doctorate, and she came to our center. And she had a discussion with students from Kyoto University. And in the discussion, they were talking about the Rohingya issue. And she was saying that in Myanmar, they respect all of the languages that are spoken. But she said, when it comes to educating people, that it's got to be done in the one language only. She was actually quite clear about it. And it's, if you want to see her say it, we've got it online, so you know it's there. So just a little comment to add there.
Just want to share a few of my observations. I really like the first movie personally because it talks about family and the connection to the activists. And I was lucky to be in the Human Rights, Human Dignity Film Festival last year in Yangon. And actually I noticed a trend that there are two, three, at least that I saw movies that talked about families and the personal stories of activists. The other one that I think really, really interesting is called Public Bullet, which talks about, well, I think it's compared to, I can't help comparing this movie with 60 Days, and I think Public Bullet is more balanced in terms of showing both male and female activists, young activists, and the stories behind. But I actually would like to see more of the tension within the families, and I think this politics of everyday life is not really shown in both movies. And in another movie that Emily mentioned, What's on Your Mind, which talked about three activists. Actually, in this movie, we see more of the tension within the families, like, and I think that makes me question the first movie, Mother and Sons. Why is the dad? You know, is that guy, the old guy, is the dad? Why is he just, you know, quiet? Or because in What's on Your Mind, we can see like the tension between the dad and the mom, and often, I don't know why, the mothers are always the most understanding ones in the family. They're always a source of strength, right? So that's my observation. But the other point is, I think what we can learn from movies like 60 Days, Thai youth, Thai young activists, as I'm really interested in activism and in my research, I work with labor activists, not with the student activists directly, but I'm really interested in following their movement. And I think what we can learn from these movies, such as the 60 Days, I think is how they organize and themselves and how they build the relationships with the public. And I think that's the most important thing in terms of comparing Thai movement and the Burmese movement. And I have to disagree with Ajahn Lalitha that we can compare the political situations easily, or we can compare the movements. And I think what we are lacking here is this kind of building strategies, and I always encourage Thai activists to learn more from, you know, exchange with the Burmese activists. And actually, whenever I talk to the Burmese activists, I always say that Thailand is now really bad, you know, worse than Burma. But they always say that we are better. They insist that we are still better. So, anyway, that is my observation.
Maybe it's an explanation. I don't know if the director really wants to say this, but for me, Burmese women always have a special place in Burmese history and Burmese society, because, you know, there are a male, and of course when you see women these days, you think about Aung San Suu Kyi, and she's a mezu to everyone. Yeah, everyone calls her Amezu. I'm not sure if they are calling her Amezu right now anymore. I'm sure they are. Yeah, but they are Amezu. Yeah, so Burmese society relates kind, generous people, sacrificing people to Ame or mother. I don't know. People like J.S. Furnival, for example. Going back to colonial period, my period. Yeah, people like Furnival, he argued that Burma always pays special attention to women rather than men. But I disagree with that. Sure, Burmese women have a special place in Burmese history because women cook, because women look after children, because women stay at home, while men have to go out and work and so on. Yeah, it's everywhere in the world. But in Burma, you see lots of activists, you see lots of important, influential people. There are women, people like Ludu Dorma, people like Aung San Suu Kyi, people like contemporary poet and writer like Nunu Yi Inwa. You know, people like this, they're really influential people. Or even somebody that we saw in the film, don't remember her name, but she looks quite different from normal Burmese lady that I've talked to. Anyway, yeah, or people like this, you know, they have special place. They have a special, very special status in Burmese society. I really don't know how I can explain this or put this into context, but all in all, I think that the film, the director just wants to, I don't know, strengthen the tone of the film. If it's the father, I don't think it would be as strong as this one. You know, because it's the mother, because the son slept right next to the mother, because he was mother's boy, things like that. If you say he's father's boy, you know, it's not Cat Stevens' song, Father and Son. But this is Burma, and has a really special place in Burmese society at large. So it's my reflection on this.
Yeah, just to touch on a couple of things that have been mentioned. You talked about how Aung San Suu Kyi is kind of seen as this mother figure now, and I would say at least in where I've been doing my film work and where I've been working on my next film project is up in Kitchen State, and they definitely do not call her mother. And actually, it's funny, I've been working with this rock band, and they're coming. I've been, part of my film is following this Kitchen rock band as they create these environmental music videos, but they're one of their songs on the next album, which is about Da Su, is actually called Gaka, which in Jingpa means oldest sister. So their reference to her, it's essentially a love song to an older sister, you know, to someone who's the oldest sister of the family, you know, because they name their children based on first daughter, second daughter, third daughter. And so, you know, it's it's as if it's a love story, you know, you used to love me, but actually, you know, you don't anymore kind of thing. So it's like this many layered meanings of essentially critique of what she's done since she's been in office. And I also wanted to mention, in part because the films have kind of left it out, is that, you know, and also the film schools that I mentioned, they're based in Yangon, and actually they don't, there have been, you know, many talented ethnic filmmakers that have come through those schools, but it's really only people who have those opportunities and privileges. But I think what we don't see is actually there's been quite a lot of videography and filmmaking in other parts of the country that don't get much attention. And I do think that the boundaries, you know, as was mentioned earlier, like testing the boundaries, pushing the boundaries, that has actually been done by lots of filmmakers, especially in the vein of music videos. And this is something that I'm personally interested in, but I think, and also, you know, I discovered a film that came out in the late 90s that was made in part because this Kitchen director, who was based in Yangon, had training from Japan. He moved to Japan. You know, there's quite a big exile connection between Kitchens going to Japan. And he came back with this new, you know, karaoke technology, and basically, you know, ended up being quite involved in this. But this particular film, Galway Miche, actually, even during the context of the ceasefire, was a huge critique for the government at that time. And the director and the screenwriter were both put in prison for several years for testing the boundaries, essentially. And that was, it was very much, it was a love story, actually, but it was also quite kind of an explicit critique against military campaigns in ethnic areas.
Okay, so is there any comments or questions? Yes, please.
Just very briefly, I really, really appreciate this dialogue between Yama and Thailand, and it really convinces me that we should do it more in Southeast Asia, rather, you know, just not just Japan. And just an additional information, we had, I think it was a previous year, we had a film about Aung San Suu Kyi's driver, bodyguard, who was also politically very much involved in her activism, all throughout her house imprisonment and up until now. But the film itself is about his wife and family. And it's very touching and interesting because you see the wife so willy-nilly having to be dragged along with his activism, but she's actually the one who's really ruling the family and making the living. So I really recommend this film to you as well. A Political Life.
Okay, thank you very much. So I think we come to the end, and I would like to thank all of you to come. You know, it's Sunday afternoon, on the mood of celebration everywhere, and it's traffic jam. So thank you very much. And please join me to thank our discussants, Emily Hong and Ajahn Lalita.